It's a common misconception that drinking 8 glasses of water a day is enough for healthy hydration. But sweat consists of water and sodium, which means you need water plus electrolytes to stay properly hydrated. Thankfully, there are products like Element that have all your electrolyte needs covered. You can try Element Recharge Sample Pack by going to drinkelement.com/speak. For only the cost of shipping.
Welcome to Speak for Yourself in Los Angeles, where the Clippers are still playing. And Marcel Smiley, we got one basketball team out here left. Emmanuel Acho, how you doing?
I hate you, big dog.
You hate me?
I hate you.
It's a thin line between love and hate. Yesterday you loved me, but now you got pushed up today. We'll get to that later, but let's get started with those Lakers. Oh, man. There's going to be a new champ in the NBA. Yep, after the Suns took care of business last night behind 47 points from Devin Booker. Anthony Davis tried to go with his strained groin, but he re-aggravated it in the first quarter and never returned. LeBron James was a perfect 14-0 in first-round matchups until last night. So, Acho, who's to blame for your Lakers' first-round exit?
LeBron James.
Him?
The GOAT.
Yes, sir.
The king, and for all those reasons, the GOAT, the king. If the Lakers would have won, which I expected, obviously you did not, I would have been up here singing LeBron James's praises. I would have been wearing vintage LeBron jerseys. I would have been wearing future LeBron jerseys. I would have done it all. Might have changed my last name to James. But since they lost, we got to be real, man. LeBron James, as one of the greatest players of all time, if not the greatest player of all time, then in the most pivotal moment, you have to be the best player on the court.
Ooh.
Period.
Ooh.
Big-time players make big-time plays in big-time
games.
You have to be the best player on the court. Devin Booker can't outshine you in that moment. I understand he's younger. I understand he's... Go ahead.
We're going to set that standard for LeBron James at this age?
The standard is
to
this.
To be better than Devin Booker
it's
right now?
It's moving, right? Had Devin Booker not been that great, LeBron, you just got to be... What do they say, Sal? You just have to be a little bit better than the opponent. You ain't got to be significantly better, whoever it was. And yesterday it was Devin Booker. LeBron had to be the best player on the court. If your team is worse than the Phoenix Suns and their best player is better than your best player, you don't have a chance.
Yeah, that's fact.
Devin Booker's not the greatest player of all time. He's not competing with Michael Jordan as the greatest of all time. Devin Booker doesn't have the highest points per game average in elimination games ever in the playoffs. No. LeBron, that's you. So I understand it is a 36-year-old fighting a 20-something-year-old in that 20-something-year-old's pre-prime. Like, Devin Booker probably hasn't even hit his prime yet. I get all that. I understand all the excuses. We all have them. But if you are LeBron the King James, who we all, at least I, hail and proclaim you as king of the court, then you got to be the best player. But here's this one, Sal. Even if he wasn't the best player, you got to play the most minutes. You got to at least go out there and just have them carry you off the court if they had to. Devin Booker can't play 46 minutes to your 41. Devin Booker can't drop 33 in the first half to your team's 41. Devin Booker can't sit there and shine on y'all after he shined on y'all in game five. I understand that you're comparing a 36-year-old to a Devin Booker in his prime, but it comes down to this. LeBron James, you're the greatest of all time, so you should be able to dominate a man even in his prime. So as I look at it, Sal, the first person to blame is LeBron James. The second person I have to blame is Frank Vogel, you play Drummond dominant minutes for 5 straight games. Then you don't come out and play him in 1 minute in game 6. That was the right decision. But the question is, why did it take you so long to find the right answer?
Sal,
when you take an aptitude test, when you take an SAT, when you take a Wonderlic test, you are on a time limit. It's not just a matter of finding the right answers. It's how much time do you have to figure out the right answer? Frank Vogel, you were on a time limit. I loved going small ball at the end of the game, particularly starting the third and fourth quarter. I love that. Take Eaton out the paint. But whether you put Gasol out there, Matthews out there, keep him out the paint. LeBron can go to the cup. If Ayton tries to help, he can dish. I love that, but it took you too long. My first slap, the third person that's to blame, Anthony Davis. Took me a while to get there.
Yeah.
But like Colin said coming into the show, you are 28 years old. Now, I'm not going to say that a 28-year-old can't get hurt. I got hurt when I was 23.
You got hurt. You got hurt when I was 18.
I got hurt when I was 19. I got hurt when I was 20.
Exactly.
Getting hurt is not a matter of age. But what's the injury, Sal? You always bring up kinesiology. I got my undergrad degree in kinesiology.
Oh, okay.
Sports management, truly, but kinesiology as well.
Do I sound smart when I bring it up?
A little bit. But y'all, we got to understand what an injury is. Anthony Davis suffered a non-contact soft tissue injury. I tore my groin against the Tennessee Titans. I was a Sunday night. Had to play Thursday against the Cowboys. That's why I knew Anthony Davis couldn't play on 4 days rest, because I'm like, oh, when I was 23 and I got hurt, same exact injury, 4 days rest, I didn't make it happen. But my injury was making a tackle with an offensive lineman pushing up against me. I heard the pop, contact injury. If you have a soft tissue injury, non-contact, now that's a matter of hydration. Now that's a matter of muscle flexibility. Now that's a matter of preventable measures. I don't ever complain, so if somebody has an ACL, somebody has an MCL, somebody has a contact injury. But you know this, if you pull a hamstring, if you pull a quad like I did at the NFL Combine because I was severely dehydrated like an idiot trying to lose weight, therefore I dehydrated myself, that is to a degree, not even to a degree, it's factually more preventable than a contact injury.
Ooh.
And so AD is to blame because we needed you. Lakers fans needed you. LeBron James needed you in the biggest moment. I'm not mad at you for getting hurt, but a soft tissue injury tells me it is more preventable than some of the other injuries. Chris Paul messed up his shoulder. Boom. Took an elbow to it.
Yeah.
Luka had a neck strain. Boom. But you messed up a groin, non-contact. To me, that's more preventable than other injuries. AD, my first slap, you got the third degree of blame.
Okay, so AD was last, and you saved the best for last because it's really about AD. You gave me a machine gun take right now. I'm just hitting that Keanu Reeves. Like, I'm trying to get away from all these bullets, but it's all about AD. Why? Because let's go to mathematical philosophy.
Talk to me,
I don't even know if they have that class, but certainly I would have signed up for it. If we could bring some objectivity to something that can be as open-ended as philosophy, I think I'm into it. I think I'm interested. Let's talk about mathematical philosophy when it comes to AD and isolate variables. Because the philosophy for the Lakers has been LeBron James, GOAT, LeBron James, King, LeBron James on the court. Who else is with him? Doesn't matter. We're going to win a championship. But that has not been the Los Angeles experience. The isolated variable in success for the Los Angeles experience has been Anthony Davis. I've been here. I wasn't even at this network when LeBron James became a Los Angeles Laker. Matter of fact, you could call me a beat writer for the Lakers since I was working at another network and we were focused and dedicated to the Lakers. And I saw LeBron James come in here and they were fourth in the West, whatever the hell that means. Some people want to make a banner of that, like that's a big deal. LeBron James on your team, you're fourth in the West. And remember, all of this started off of the conversation. Oh, it's going to be different in the West for you, LeBron. We'll see when you go West. And he ends up being fourth, then he gets injured. Then he comes back from injury and says, let's activate, playoff activation, whatever the hell he said. I didn't pay attention to it because I knew it wasn't going to work. What happened? It didn't work. They didn't make the playoffs. You remember that. Year one. Year two, you know, Rich Paul, you know, doing what he does, top agent in the game, got the baddest player in the game in LeBron James, made it happen. Anthony Davis, one of his clients, shows up with the Lakers. They win a championship from not going to the playoffs. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, basically. So, you know, you got to respect that. That's a climb. This year, AD's out the lineup even more so than LeBron James. So they're sputtering along to the point where they're in the play-in championship. Uh-oh, we borderline not playoffs again. Anthony Davis goes down in this series, and it's a wrap. They were outscored by 47 points once AD went down. It's just that simple. You can talk about LeBron's greatness, but if you bring up his greatness, you got to go back to yesteryear. He's still a tremendous player. He's still maybe top five, being real. Forget who he is. Talking about his game right now, he's probably top five because he got to pick his spots too often. That's what comes with age. But if you want to talk about why the Lakers right now will be in Cancun, it's because Anthony Davis had to tap out. Now, let me bring up the part that you brought up in terms of injury.
Yes, sir.
Because I think a lot of people are talking about injury in terms of negligence. And I was injury prone. But it's not always negligence. Now, it's not always you fully invested in your body.
Correct. Yes,
there's
sir.
A big difference.
Yes, sir.
Here's the thing. How many of us in our 20s knew about biomechanics to the point where we could address all of our issues before they became injury? There's something called prehab that
yes,
I
sir.
Learned later in my career.
Yes, sir.
When I grew up, I never heard the word prehab. And I'm all American, high school, college, all this kind of stuff. I never heard the word. And then all of a sudden you get to a pro level, middle career. Hey, what's your prehab look like? What you mean? I work out. I do what I got to do. And then I started to learn what triggers some of these issues and injuries. With AD, it's not just hydration, even though it is. It's not just are you committed to stretching and elasticity.
Yes,
It's also, do you know that your buttocks may not be firing properly,
correct,
which is throwing your hips out of alignment,
correct,
which is throwing your groin out of alignment.
Okay.
So that's not negligence. That may be not fully understanding, aware, or invested, but that's not negligence.
But I think,
and that's fixable.
I think it's negligence at this point.
Come on.
You 9 years in, big dog. My freshman year at Texas, I tore my meniscus.
Okay.
My sophomore year at Texas, I had a sports hernia week one, played all the way through it, national championship game. We lose surgery the next day. My junior year at Texas, I tear my MCL. After that point, I'm like, okay, Acho, what the hell going on now? Mm-hmm. You 6'2", 237, had 5.7% body fat at the time.
Damn.
So I'm like, it's not a matter of you don't take care of your body, but I'm like, what is going on? So all I did now that summer before my senior year, now I'm doing balancing drills.
Yeah.
Now I'm doing stuff like, hey, I'm going to strengthen all these knee muscles. Now okay. I'm doing resistance band behind the legs. I'm strengthening my quads.
Okay.
Now I'm getting massage therapists on top of the massage therapist Texas is paying for. I'm like, hey, I'm about to be a senior. Can't afford to get hurt. It's time to do more. I had been in college for 3 years. I said, hey, big dog, you're not getting hurt this senior year. Senior year, I don't get hurt. Third team All-American in the AP poll. I did everything I accomplished because after 3 years, Sal, it's enough. When I was a child, I acted like a child. But when I became a man, I put away them childish things.
Okay.
AD is in year nine, Marcellus
Wiley.
Okay,
hold on, but Acho.
And here's the other thing, real
you,
quick.
Man, you about to fall into this pit.
Because look, so now I go to the combine.
I'm about to say, so don't act like that was your last injury.
So now I go to the combine.
And then
I go to the combine, I was like, I got to weigh a lot. I got to weigh a lot. Linebackers got to be 6'2", about 240.
Let's talk.
So before they do the weigh-in test, I chug two muscle milks.
Go.
Enough that. I chug two things of water. Go. Good. Weigh in, 238. Okay, good. 6'2", 238. We good. But I'm thinking to myself, like an idiot, well, the lighter you are, the faster you run. Within 2 days, I go from 238 to 229. Dehydrated, the time to run the 40. I'm sprinting. All of a sudden, I hear boom. I thought my heels were clicking. No big deal. I'm sprinting. I try to push through it. Bam. Tore my quad right off the bone.
Let me see that form again. That's why. Crossing your body. What you doing?
Here like this. Boom, quad right off the bone. Dehydrated soft tissue injury. I told you I tore my groin in the NFL. Contact injury. I broke my thumb in the NFL trying to force a fumble on Darren Sproles. Contact injury. After that moment, my only times getting hurt were either contact or being an idiot. 9 years into the NBA, Anthony Davis does not have the excuse at this point in time, Sal, to suffer an injury and us not a soft tissue injury. I'm not comparing it to Chris Paul. And us not at least start to examine, okay, AD, what's going on, big dog?
What's going on
here?
Oh, you in that camp.
I'm examining
through a colored lens. That means what you're doing wrong, not what is going on. He started the year off, and I told y'all this, and y'all laughed at me with my fake degrees. I just been hurt so much that I act like I got a degree. He had tendinosis. What did I tell you? Oh, see, you did it again. He keeps smacking his teeth. When he had that tendinosis, what did I tell you? I said, oh, it ain't over in terms of the injuries.
Correct.
And then he missed 36 games.
Yes, sir.
He played 36 games.
Yes, sir.
You know this about muscles.
Yes.
You can't skip steps.
You can't.
Okay? I hate when people come up to you and they say, oh, you could just go back and ride it like a bike. I was like, no, you don't, because this is how muscles work. You tear them down or build them back up through recovery, right? You stress them. And then they get torn. Fibers are torn. They're weaker. You recharge through fuel, through food, through rest, and then they come back and build stronger. But here's the thing. When you have tendinosis, it's going to affect your alignment from
everywhere. The whole kinetic chain is off.
The worst injuries to have are foot injuries, tendinosis, Achilles, because everything's going to be thrown out of alignment all the time. Walking around to the mall is going to be a problem for you in terms of your kinetic chain. Here we go. He has tendinosis. He only plays 36 games. And everybody's saying, okay, we'll come back at the end of the season. Why? You need to get some chemistry with LeBron. You need to know how you're going to play with Andre Drummond. You need to just come back into the lineup. And Anthony Davis was in the lineup when LeBron wasn't. Even more stress. Your muscles have been broken down because they're out of alignment because of the tendinosis. So it's not just dehydration. You're not going to the right doctor. It's because you have made a choice to put all of this on a weak foundation. So he goes into the playoffs. Mm-hmm. He plays a bad game one.
Yes,
who
sir.
Knows the reason why? Game two, game three, balling. Here's the thing. I remember when the devil asked for his receipts. Because you make a deal with the devil when you are not in proper conditioning, mm-hmm. but you're trying to tax yourself. So AD went out there and he finally saw the devil. He said, man, move. Wait till the next series. No, wait till the offseason. The devil said, nah, dog, my money due right now. And then all of a sudden, snap. This has nothing to do with how much Gatorade he had. This has nothing to do with did he go to sleep that night. This has to do with the fact that he had a weakened foundation from the beginning of the season, and he put too much on it in a playoff time. The stressors is what
So you're right. He had a weakened foundation at the beginning of the season, but what's that stem from? The off season.
They had no off season
this year.
But it's a whole body of work. What do they talk about?
And he was hurt last year.
If you don't sleep long enough, you can't just try to get one night's sleep and think you're going to be all right. Facts. Because you start to talk about the word residual.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
Residual.
Yes, yes,
what kind of deposits are you making over time? So your boy could go to In-N-Out Burger after the show, and I probably
and
will.
And I probably
But the next
you.
Day, I'm still probably, hopefully, going to have abs. Because there's residual workouts that have lasted that can conquer the In-N-Out Burger, the double double, then I'm a smash. Smash
one. Okay.
What is the residual deposits to Anthony Davis' health that he is putting in, even in a shortened offseason? Is there residual health deposits that he is putting in to make sure that he can maintain the duration of the season? Now, remember, we still got to go to the fact of, should he have played or not?
Hell no, he shouldn't have played.
Because that's a conversation that I think you and I can have at a higher capacity than any other show on sports because you and I both play the game.
Yes, yes.
You say he shouldn't have played.
No, facts.
I agree, but I understand why he did.
Yes, agree too.
You feel me?
Like, yeah, oh, yeah.
Anthony Davis had to play. And he had to play for a couple reasons. While this man is sitting in rehab, Anthony Davis sitting in rehab, while he's on the bike, while he's getting acupuncture, et cetera, he watching sports shows. Might be watching Speak, might be watching Undisputed, might be watching The Herd, might be watching First Things First. He definitely ain't watching the other networks. So he might be watching sports shows, and on those sports shows, you know what they're saying?
What they say?
Man, you hear Charles Barkley called him street clothes because he's always in street clothes. That's he ain't never
one.
Healthy.
That's a good one.
That is great.
That's a great show.
So think about this. Anthony Davis is like, yo, they out here making fun of me because I ain't healthy. Man, I can't hang LeBron out to dry. If I hang LeBron out to dry, I'm going to get blamed by guys like Marcellus Wiley in the A block for hanging him out to dry. So I got to play. Now, I'm going to give y'all some experience. I'm going to put y'all on game that other shows aren't going to tell y'all about. Again, I got hurt. Tore my groin against the Tennessee Titans. It was on Sunday. Had to play 4 days later against the Dallas Cowboys on Thanksgiving.
You didn't have to play.
I didn't, but here's why I say I had to.
Yeah, exactly.
You know where I'm from. I'm from Dallas. Thanksgiving Day game. That's the biggest game the Cowboys play every day. I'm in Philly. It's the one time I'm finally starting. My first year, I got hurt in Cleveland. My second year, I'm practice squad. Now, I'm finally starting. The game's in Dallas in 4 days. I did everything. Private therapy, public therapy, acupuncture, everything. Prayed, laid hands, all of it. Before the game, the head coach, Chip Kelly, the general manager, Howie Roseman-Stell, the linebacker coach, Rick Minder, and the defensive coordinator, Bill Davis, they all worked me out. Backpedal, break, backpedal, break, backpedal, break. Individual drills, you get cleared. Anthony Davis did the same thing. That's why he said the medical team had to clear him. You go through individual drills. Here's the kicker, y'all. When you playing in a real game, you can't calculate your movements ahead of time. So I'm watching the game. I know AD going to get hurt. I strained my groin on 4 days rest. AD strained his groin on 4 days rest. But the other reason I knew Sell was this. Why didn't AD take the tip off? Y'all ain't notice? Marc Gasol took the tip. AD's
he taller,
more athletic. AD can reach further. Why didn't he take the tip?
You know why.
Back in the locker room before coming out on the court. He's reaching at his groin. I knew instantly he was thinking about it, and thus he was going to get hurt. But he had to play, because if he didn't play, he was going to get clowned. He plays and gets hurt, he gets clowned. He's messed up either way, Sal.
Man, you went there. And I love, you know, your experience is your expertise, and nobody can negate that. And you are absolutely correct. I've been to that same mental place where AD was last night. I'll talk about it. But first, let me give him his flowers. Because before we start talking about what he was going through mentally, let's just talk about what this team is going through and what AD needs, his flowers. Mm-hmm. He pulled a Dak Prescott. He showed his true value to this organization in absence. Not so much, like, because no one gives AD credit. And I've been banging on that drum for a year or so. But it's hard to hear it when the GOAT is in the building, just muffling all that noise. But AD is the reason why the Lakers won a championship last year, if you want to say driving force. Don't believe me? Look what happened to the Lakers without AD. Simple as that. Now, let's talk about that mental place, that cocktail that he was over there sipping on. Ooh, that cocktail, man, is delicious. And it's sad that we all sipped it before. You talked about your experience. It's almost a combination of brand building at pressure. Mm-hmm. Now, the brand building is really coming from the fact that you keep hearing these naysayers, these critics, Charles Barkley clowning you, whoever it is clowning you. And you're like, I know what my brand is. I'm a tremendous basketball player who can't stay healthy. This is a moment where I can clear all that up. But you're not ready. And then that pressure starts to talk to you, too. And that pressure is sitting there like, man, you ain't ready. Mm-hmm. But then your other shoulder sitting there like, I know you're not ready, but this is the perfect time to show them that mm-hmm. you're bigger than that. And he goes out there and tries to play. I knew he wasn't going to play well. I said it yesterday. I said, ain't no way he should play. Yep. Ain't no way he is going to play. And then he's going to use the medical staff as cover. And they went out there, instead of throwing out the towel, knowing that their fighter didn't have a chance to make it through the round, mm-hmm. they let him go out there and get killed. And we saw it happen right before our eyes. Happened to RG3 as well, your mm-hmm. boy.
Yes, sir.
And I remember that moment as well. Like, no, these athletes, I say it now from this position up here on this studio desk. Stop doing that to yourselves. But I also talked to the younger version of me, who did the same damn mm-hmm. thing. I broke my foot week one in San Diego after signing the biggest deal in Chargers history. Think about it. They can't do nothing to me. And I kind of knew that. But I still went out there and sipped from that cocktail of brand building. Oh, y'all not going to pay me the money, and I'm just going to tuck it and then chill out, and y'all going to catch me at the mall on crutches. And the pressure of, are you going to live up to that money? Mm-hmm. Are you going to earn it? It's sad to see it because Anthony Davis is the future for the Lakers. The Lakers going to go anywhere going forward, and we'll discuss this on other topics. It's not going to be because of LeBron. It's not going to be because of the King and the GOAT. It's going to be because of Anthony Davis, if he heals. Coming up, Damian Lillard had a memorable first round. Woo! But it was not enough. We'll tell you if Dame will get out of Portland. But first, will the Lakers' first round exit take any shine off their title? Wow. We'll answer that next on Speak for Yourself. Medical edition, boy. Woo-hoo-hoo. Stories.
The Lakers won a title last year in the bubble, but there was a different result this season. LA was eliminated last night in the first round by the Suns. Head coach Frank Vogel said the season was a challenge and added the injuries to Anthony Davis and LeBron James were, quote, just too much. We got to bring in an NBA analyst, Slick Rick, for this one because last night's loss to the Suns makes you raise questions, not just about last night, but also about the Lakers' recent history. So, Sal,
yes?
Does a first-round exit the Lakers just suffered take any shine off their bubble title?
No, it does not for me. And the bubble title, oh, let me clarify this for the 740th, 90th, 1,000th time. It was an asterisk year last year, and the Lakers are the champions of an asterisk year. You don't believe me? Look at this year, and you can see a huge difference, not only with the Lakers, not only with the Miami Heat, but also some of these injuries we keep discussing. So last year's team is not this year's team. So why would it take shine off of this year's team? As Nick Saban always says, no team is going out there trying to repeat as champions because every team is different. Oh, you don't believe me? Okay. Anybody seen Rondo play this year for the Lakers? Yeah, yeah. I can keep going with names, as y'all know. So the point is, this is a different team, so I'm going to respect what they did and make it different than last year, mutually exclusive. However, in this situation with the Lakers, the only thing I can see, because everyone's going to take this shot and try to say, oh, take the shine off of this year because last year was a bubble slash asterisk, is this. The fact that they couldn't recover, the fact that that five-month layoff really was advantageous for not only LeBron at his age, but Anthony Davis and his health, you can parlay some of that into this moment and say, well, the reason the Lakers came up short, LeBron and his age, Anthony Davis and his injuries. So I can see that common denominator. But outside of that, because the personnel is different, because you look at the coaching staff, there's changes there, upstairs, everywhere you look is not the exact same team, condition, or situation, I say no, don't try and steal shine from this year's team.
Yes, there's no shine taken off of LA's title last year in the bubble. I don't believe in bubble frauds, not the Miami Heat, not the Boston Celtics, not the Los Angeles Lakers. Here is why, Slick Rick, I see you give me a look. Sports are a man-made game based upon a contrived set of rules that are ever adjusting. The epitome of sport is actually how well can you adjust to the set of rules. In football, there used to be a time where you could hit defenseless receivers. Then all of a sudden, you couldn't. How well can you adjust to a set of rules? Let me take y'all into the locker room or onto the field real quick.
During practice, any football practice, you'll be going through a drill and all of a sudden you will hear a screeching loud scream and it'll say this, sudden change! Sudden change. All of a sudden the drill has to change instantly because your coach is trying to remind you during the course of a game, something will change because that is the epitome of game. Things are constantly changing. Last year, during the NBA season, the world yelled, sudden change! 5-month halt in basketball. Who could adjust? The Lakers adjusted better than everybody else. They were beneficiaries more so than any other team. It didn't affect all the Lakers greatly. I'm sure Kuzma didn't benefit from 5 months off. He can't focus on the court, so I doubt he could focus off of it. But the likes of LeBron James and Anthony Davis did benefit. So I don't believe the Lakers are bubble frauds. I don't believe their championship deserved an asterisk last year. Definitely doesn't deserve an asterisk this year because game is all about change and adjusting to change. And the Lakers did that last year. It's just this year didn't go the same way.
To change! I heard that. I'm sorry.
Acho, you can believe that. Marcellus can believe that. I, in a perfect world and in my mind, believe that. But the world is not just this show. And the reality is, there, for all the reasons that Marcellus pointed out, there are plenty of people out there that are going to look at this first round exit and then look back at the bubble and go, huh, were they really champions? I mean, were they really champions? And to your point, it's a different team. To me, the loss was last summer when they made the roster moves that changed this team profoundly. Last year's team, prior to the bubble, was 6-2 without Anthony Davis. This year's team wasn't capable of playing that way. So there was a significant difference. However, there was also the mindset. And maybe it's not the, it didn't take the shine off of the Lakers championship. It took the shine off of LeBron and Anthony Davis and Rob Pelinka and their part in last year's championship. Because the belief was that these guys demonstrated, oh, you just need to give them a couple of pieces. But this is really about Anthony Davis and LeBron James coming together and Rob Pelinka picking up Dwight Howard and a bunch of pieces off of the salvage heap. And they were champions. And now we look at this team with a roster that was supposed to be better than last year's team and was, I dare say, more expensive, and they couldn't even get out of the first round. So, in a perfect world, no, it doesn't take anything off of last year. That's a standalone event. But, gentlemen, we do not live in a perfect world. We will retroactively go back and look and say, to Marcellus's point, I mean, how do you put an asterisk on it now and yet say there's no shine taken off of it? Just because of the difference, this was a different year too. They didn't play a full 82-game season. Mm-hmm. They didn't have a full off season. Mm-hmm. You could put an asterisk on the fact that they were knocked out in the first round the same way you could put an asterisk on them winning a championship.
Well, I don't know if asterisks have lowercase and uppercase, but last year was uppercase. This year, maybe lowercase because, you know, abbreviated season, 72 games. But the point is, Slick, you done brought me into a place where I'm going to take the suit off and get dirty and muddy with you. Let me talk about what this asterisk looks like. Because last year, if the Clippers would have won, you wouldn't have heard me publicly say it. But privately, I've been like, yeah, that was an asterisk championship. Because I keep telling people this. You're looking at the national champion and a national record holder and running the 400 meters. And if my coach ever said we had a race set up like this, we're going to run 300, stop. Take 5 months off, come back and run the last 100. I'm going to say, sign me up for that race. And they signed the Lakers up for that race. They signed the entire NBA up for that race. But whoever wins that race, the Lakers of last year, that ain't the champion like that. Like that, like the 400 meters I used to have to run. So most NBA champions are sitting there privately saying, man, that ain't the same kind of ring we won. But I digress. Let's talk about that team last year of the champions. You guys, I want to see your faces because you laugh every time I brought this stat up. You laugh every time. Let's see who laughs last. Of the 18 champions since 2003, during their postseason run, the Lakers allowed the most points per game, highest opponent field goal percentage, and highest opponent three-point percentage. Now, y'all used to laugh because I was like, yo, those numbers support that maybe this is a weak
champion in terms of how they perform. Now, we look at this first-round exit, play-in championship to even become a first-round exit team. It's starting to make some sense that, like you said, Rob Pelinka and those guys didn't look at this team properly in terms of the holes that they needed to fill. But I'm not going to damn the Lakers in completion because they are the sixth defending champion since 1984 to lose in the first round. So they're not setting any kind of history right here. They're not the first team to do this. There are six of them, including the Lakers. But it's still kind of weird coming off the asterisk year that you're going to pull this stunt right after.
I'm about to say something that's going to make y'all's head hurt and y'all are intelligent. So I'm really about to tug at your mental strings. Because, Slick, you brought up a point I hadn't heard before, but now I actually agree with. If we're being real, this year deserves more of an asterisk than the others. And here's why, Sal. Is sports not a measure of excellence as opposed to a measure of longevity? The reason so many people say that Michael Jordan is the greatest basketball player of all time is not because he has more longevity than LeBron James, but Michael Jordan's highs were higher than LeBron James's highs.
See that?
So if we are comparing the best of Jordan to the best of LeBron and Jordan wins, then shouldn't we use the same argument as far as titles? This year isn't even about who's more talented. It's about who can last the longest. Luka, you gonna get hurt? Jamal Murray, dang, man, you got an ACL. Spidey Mitchell, thank goodness you came back. AD, just trying to survive your own health. Joel Embiid, you just got hurt again. Look at the Boston Celtics, made it to the Eastern Conference Finals. They got bounced 4-1. The Heat made it to the Eastern Conference Finals. They got bounced 4-0. The Lakers made it to the NBA Finals, won the NBA Finals. They just got bounced in the first round. Maybe, just maybe. Oh, yeah, I didn't mention the Nuggets, who lost their star scorer because he got hurt. Maybe, just maybe, this shortening of this season is actually not a matter of who's the most talented team that's going to win this year. It's just a matter, Sal, of who can last the longest. To bring it in a track analogy and then, Slick, I'm going to pass the baton.
Here we go.
Sell, don't take a bunch of 100-meter short sprinters, tell them to run a 400, and then try to brag about who's the better 100-meter runner after they ran the 400. That don't make no sense. What we're doing in this year's NBA is saying, okay, it's not really who's the most talented team, but who can stay the healthiest over a period of no offseason? Who can stay the healthiest over a period of 1 month off? Because we know, and it's not coincidence, that three of the four teams that made it to the Final Four last year, when you talk about their conference finals, are already gone, and it's just June 4th. It's not a matter of talent this year. It's just a matter of health.
Okay, so but there's two ways to look at that, Acho, I love the way you set this up. Because if we are going to have compensation for what happened this year, then don't we have to have compensation for what happened last year? Mm-hmm. Can we not say that, yes, three of the four are gone already? Okay, so maybe three of the four that made it last year were paper tigers in the same way that they were able to take advantage of those special circumstances last year in a way that they could not this year.
So Slick,
I'm okay dropping.
I got to interrupt you, and here is why, Slick.
And please go ahead.
Here is why,
it's your show,
Slick. If we're looking at all these teams, Slick, Sal, we're looking at the four teams that made it the furthest last year. It's not a coincidence they all out. It's also not a coincidence that three of the four teams lost their top two, one of their top two best players. Sal, you're giggling.
I am giggling. This is,
it ain't a coincidence.
You sound like
Jamal Murray. It ain't a coincidence. it's not a coincidence that all these teams that made it the furthest, who had the shortest offseason, are hurt. So yes, maybe they robbed Peter to pay Paul is what it comes down to. And at least the Lakers still got paid.
You want to finish, Slick, before I finish laughing with Acho?
No, go ahead. Go ahead, Celis. Okay. I think you got something.
What's funny is I'm up here doing my duty analyzing the war of attrition. But it sounds like Acho's not. He want to pick a side. And he sounds like LeBron. Because did y'all hear LeBron post-game?
What'd he say?
Because this is so funny. LeBron is blaming health and failure, but not in success necessarily. I'll get to that in a second. Oh, the opponents have been injured on your road to success. So sometimes you're going to be the one that's injured on your road to failure. Just that simple. Here's LeBron postgame. It doesn't matter to me as far as not making it out the first round. Yeah, okay, buddy. What matters to me is getting this team back healthy. Uh-oh, you know me. Ding, 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 ding. Excuse. Me not being able to be at full strength. Ding, 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 ding. Another excuse. Here he goes. It wasn't me. It was the broke down version of me. Let's talk about broke down versions and why LeBron James has some of those rings. Y'all remember his second championship run? I do. With the Heat. Play the Bulls team. What was D-Rose? Anybody? D-Rose! Oh, no, you still take that championship. Let's go. Third championship run with the Cavs down 3-1. Remember Draymond Green got suspended? Where Draymond? Everybody says that had an impact, had an effect. Last year in the bubble, where was Steph? Where was Klay? Where was KD? Where was Kyrie? Giannis was out there with one ankle. Oh, so in success, it's funny. We don't want to bring up all the war of attrition. Only in failure, LeBron, Acho. Can't have it both ways. Coming up, Dame time is not clicking after another first-round exit. We'll tell you if he'll get out of Portland. Ooh, this is going to be excellent. That's next on Speak for Yourself. Can't bring that up now, Brian. Sunday, NASCAR's best season ever continues as the Cup Series pulled into Sonoma for the Toyota Save Mart 350, where the best drivers in the world look to hit victory lane in wine country. Sunday, 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific, only on FS1 and the Fox Sports app. Send me some of that wine, y'all. Speaking of NASCAR, Sunday, don't miss your chance to win $10,000 in Clint Bowyer's money during the NASCAR Cup Series race from Sonoma. Download the Fox Bet Super 6 app and answer 6 questions about Stage 2 for your shot to win. Damian Lillard came off his epic 55-point Game 5 performance with 28 last night, but it was not enough. His Blazers were eliminated by the Nuggets and have now lost 4 out of the last 5 seasons in the first round. Dame said, quote, obviously, where we are isn't good enough to win a championship. Sorry, Dame, that wasn't you, it was me. Latest exit sparked chatter about his future in Portland. He fueled the fire by posting a Nipsey Hussle lyric, quote, how long should I stay dedicated? How long till opportunity meet preparation? But his focus was not on the future after the game. Take a listen.
You know, to come up short in the first round, and, you know, our season to end on our home floor is disappointing. That's as far as I am with it right now. You know, I'm not really thinking about none of the other change or whatever, man. You know, we'll see what happens, but I haven't even thought that far out.
First of all, I want to look that clean every day of my life. God, that, you know, that just like Marvin Gaye look? Like, that's clean. All right, so Acho, will Damian Lillard get out of Portland?
Yeah, he will get out. He'll get out because, honestly, Sal, he has to. Athletes, I understand your dedication, your loyalty to your city, but understand the person you should be most dedicated and loyal to is yourself.
Yes.
Dame, you've been in Portland 9 years. 8 years, y'all have consecutively made the playoffs, the longest streak in NBA history currently right now of NBA teams in the last 8 years, that is. And so, Dame, you looking, and y'all good, but good has not been good enough. Dame, you also got to understand what history looks like. And we said this a couple days ago. Kevin Garnett was incredibly dedicated. He was in Minnesota for 12 years. Finally, at the age 31, he was like, man, I got a dip.
Anything's possible.
Anything is possible. It was. He left at 31. He won him a chip.
Yes,
we also saw Ray Allen. Age of 31, he dipped too.
Mm-hmm.
And he joined Kevin Garnett. Age of 31, he finally got him his first chip. James Harden, he was loyal to Houston. Age of 31, he's now dipped and gone to Brooklyn. We will see what happens. Dame, you're about to turn 31 here in a few days, few months now.
Mm.
It might be time for you to make that same decision. The reason I think Dame needs to get out of Portland is you've had a first-round exit in 4 out of the last 5 years.
Whew.
You and CJ clearly aren't getting it done together, plus Nurk, et cetera. Your coach probably going to be gone.
Ghost.
One of your top 3 players alongside you probably going to be gone. And realistically speaking, Dame, what's easier? Is it easier for you to make all the pieces around you change or you to just get up and change your piece? What happened to Kevin Durant? He was sitting in OKC. He was in OKC, I think it was 9 years, OKC plus Seattle. He there for about 9-10 years, still, and he's like, you know what? I've already had a couple pieces come and go. James Harden, you've left. Russell Westbrook, you've gotten better, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But rather than trying to continue to change everything around me, maybe I should just change my location.
Mm.
And he changed his location, and he instantly won him a chip. I think it's time now for Dame. It's not even a matter of letting loyalty lie. It's choosing to be loyal to yourself over others.
Mm. I love it. You got me thinking over here. You got me writing down stuff that I didn't write down earlier in preparation for this moment. And then watching Dame once again and just feeling how
He is feeling this moment differently than he's felt the other playoff losses. You can see the difference. When he says, we will see what happens versus I'm a Portland trailblazer and all of that dedication, you can see he's going through it. Acho, let me answer the question. Will Damian Lillard get out of Portland? No. Does Damian Lillard want to get out of Portland? Yes. Should he want to get out of Portland? Yes. Will he get out? No. And I'm going to tell you why. Because his heart is not fully into getting out of Portland. Let's talk about the heart of Damian Lillard. Because right now, all this want and all of this stuff, wants without a plan is just a wish. Mm-hmm. Wish I could get out of here, but the plan, oh, I don't want to go through all of that. And Damian Lillard is going to have to go through some things to get out of Portland. He's going to have to go to James Harden level. He's going to have to get gang-related with Portland to get out of there. And Portland's going to do everything for Damian Lillard like they've done all this time to this point. Here's the thing. So the first card, they're not going to do anything. Damian, what do you need? You know what I need? I need us to advance. I need us to win a championship. Okay, how? Well, you know what? We need A, B, C. Done. And Damian, see, that's not done for Damian because he's like, I don't even think that's going to work, but that's as best we could do. Mm-hmm. So then they're going to say, we're good? Nah. Ah, and here we go. Because now Portland's sitting there playing Uno. They looking at their cards. This one says loyalty. And they say, hey, it's a draw four, too. It's like, if Damian, if you want to go beyond, we gave you everything you want again, and it hasn't worked, loyalty card. And then persona. Because right now there's a huge campaign for Damian Lillard to get out of there because everyone feels his pain. But Portland hasn't fought back yet. They haven't given him everything he wanted this offseason, every year up to this point. Yes, that loyalty card hits. Damian Lillard's not ready to go to James Harden level. This guy is of high character. And here's the problem. You can go somewhere else, Damian Lillard. You're going to have to go James Harden gangster. But once you land there, did you compromise that high character to get there? Damian's the realest. Like, this ain't no act. Mm-hmm. And this guy has the Midas touch, and he's tired of not getting his gold. He's tired of having the Midas touch, got every endorsement, got all that money, got all that game, and doesn't have all his gold. Mm-hmm. So he wants to go. He wishes he can go. But what it's going to take for him to go there, I don't see that man of character going to that place.
I think eventually you have to understand that, you can't compromise your character, but you got to find a way to get these championships.
I know.
Can you capture a championship without compromising your character? KD couldn't. Can you capture a championship without compromising your character? Harden couldn't. Can you capture a championship without compromising your character? LeBron couldn't.
Close. But he went through the fire of the decision.
LeBron went through the whole decision. The reason LeBron, for the most part, outside of the political reasons for those people, hate LeBron the most is the decision.
Say it.
So I was drafted to the Cleveland Browns a year after LeBron James made the decision. Poster's gone. I'm walking through the queue. I think that's the name of the arena. I'm walking through the queue in Cleveland. I don't see a LeBron picture. Go to the owner's suite. I walk through the tunnel, the little locker rooms. I'm like, wait, didn't like one of the greatest players of all time, didn't he play? No LeBron, nothing. LeBron had to compromise his character for a championship, but I think they would all say it's worth it. Because we can call KD a sellout. We can call KD a punk. We can call KD a snake. You know what we can't call him?
What?
You can't say he never won a championship.
Yeah.
Like, you can call AD all you want to call KD, but the one thing I better call KD is a champion. That's what when I talk about KD, I'm also forced to call him a champion. When we talk about Dame, 22 and 39 in the postseason, the worst winning percentage of all time with a minimum of 60 games played. Actually, one person worse, his teammate, Carmelo Anthony. So when you talk about Dame and we want to talk about all Dame's game, you quickly see the stat that Dame is 0-10 versus Steph Curry in the playoffs. Like, we can talk about all the greatness of Dame, but he can't escape these maximal losses unless he goes somewhere else.
I mean, yeah, unless he goes somewhere else. But that road is not a smoothly paved road.
It's not, but it's worth it.
Oh, it's first of all, it's not worth it until you go somewhere else, go through that fire, and succeed there. Because it ain't worth it if you go there and you another first round exit somewhere else with a different color on. Like, you be God dang, dog. Like, you be like, what the hell did I just do? And it does not always work out for everybody. It's interesting. Dame. See, I go back and forth with Dame, turns DM and texts all this stuff. So respect to Dame and how great a person he is, how great a person and character he is. But to get this done, I'm
foreseeing Portland not being so satisfied and happy losing Damian Lillard. They're going to put up a fight. And if they put up a fight, what fight will Dame put up to get out of their grasp? Think about it, big dog. To get out, he would have to stray so far from the image he's created, so far from the brand and the persona that he has based off of high character. How can he get there?
Question, Sal. LeBron's brand, LeBron's image, LeBron everything. I'm just a kid from Akron. Now you playing in Cleveland, which is what, an hour and change from Akron.
Yeah.
LeBron is tied forever to Cleveland. And he still went to South Beach.
No, but
he
He
done built a school in Cleveland.
Yes.
He done everything in Cleveland. How?
This, you want to know why?
Please.
LeBron was the windshield, as I always tell people. The pioneer, the first one. He took all the hits. And then now everybody else after it has taken hits, but not to that same degree. And also everyone after it knew that they were going to take hits. Now, do they raise their hand for those hits? James Harden did, because James Harden got a different personality and different way of looking at things. KD did, and I love how KD looks at things. But I don't know if Damian Lillard wants to be looked at the way that he's going to be looked at if he pulls that off. So here's the thing. Damian Lillard is seeing LeBron do that, and LeBron did that with ignorance. And it's not even like a diss.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't know that people were going to flip on him like that.
No idea.
LeBron, I didn't flip on you. I thought it was the smartest decision in the world. That's why it was called the decision. It was smart. But everybody else flipped on him. I was like, these people are stupid. But these people did. So is Damian Lillard going to go to that place with no guarantees that wherever he goes, it's going to work?
Let me give you a better comparison.
Let's go.
Russell Wilson. Russell Wilson, probably the most famous Seattle Seahawk of all time. Russell Wilson has been nothing but loyal and dedicated to the Seahawks. But Russell Wilson has hit a breaking point, ain't gone to a championship since 2013-14, is 1-4 in his last five playoff games. Russell Wilson this year was like, you know what? I'll go to the Saints. I'll go to the Bears. He gave a list of destinations. I think at least if there is a fair comp, Russell Wilson has that same loyalty tie. Go 12s. Go Hawks.
Yeah, that's facts. Facts. Like, I see the parallels. However, where is he going? Nowhere. Pete Carroll got that dude saying, look, you're going to hand this ball off this year. We're going back to the running game and playing some defense, too. And I'm not going to call Russell Wilson confused, but his brand all over the place now. And because he has cover, he with Sierra. So, you know, now he got a deeper voice. How you get a deeper voice in your 20s? And he got cornrows one day, it's curly the next. Like, that ain't Damian Lillard. Damian Lillard is so good at everything he does. And to be Midas without all your gold is a struggle, brother. He's better than 90% of even the rappers. He don't even need to play basketball. And he still can't get it. But to go through that fire, and there's no guarantee that you're going to succeed, I'm not sure if he's going to do it. Coming up, CeeDee Lamb is pulling the T.O., Terrell Owens, and telling everyone to get their popcorn ready. All right. Tell you if he sounds overconfident. Next, don't speak for yourself. Russ ain't went nowhere. CeeDee Lamb is showing a lot of confidence heading into his second season. Showed up to practice with a Get Your Popcorn Ready bracelet in honor of Terrell Owens. Hope he's getting some of that money. But that's not it. Lamb made a bold claim about his wide receiver group, saying when they lock in, they could, quote, take the top off anyone. Okay, hey. Acho, the CeeDee Lamb with that fresh name, sound overconfident?
So he don't sound overconfident. He just sounds unnecessarily confident.
Ooh.
Right? Like, he's exactly right. The receiving core can take the top off of any defense. Amari Cooper, Michael Gallup, CeeDee Lamb. I think that's probably the best trio in football. All three of them almost had 1,000 yards last year without Dak. They will all have 1,000 yards this year if they stay healthy, mark my words, plus there's an extra game. Here is the problem, though, with the Cowboys. CeeDee's accomplishing and he's verbalizing something that's not the goal. So, you know, if you ever watch a cooking show, they'll be like, okay, your instruction is to bake this strawberry cake. So you watch all these people baking a strawberry cake, you being the judge, and then some person shows up with a beautiful, immaculate, perfect brownie. And you're like, the brownie looks amazing, and it probably tastes great, but the objective was to bake a strawberry cake. The objective for the Cowboys and Cowboys fans is to win championships.
Okay.
The objective isn't to amass 1,000 yards as a receiver. It's not to accumulate 2,000 yards as a running back. It's not to take the top off of defenses. It's not to pass for 6,000 yards, Dak Prescott. The objective is to win championships, something the Cowboys haven't done since CeeDee Lamb was born. So I don't think he is overconfident. I just think his confidence is misplaced.
What's your real objective? I'm tired of hearing the Cowboys talk about being great at things that aren't ultimately important.
Whoa.
That's my issue, Sal. Is like, whoa, they're talking about having all this talent, passing for all these yards, receiving for all these yards, but that's really not the ultimate goal. Now, the counter could be, well, Acho, if they do take the top off of defenses, they'll win a ton of games. Not necessarily. Dak Prescott was taking the top off of defenses last year, and he started off 1-3. So I just wish the Cowboys would focus on the ultimate goal.
Man, what they say, everything in moderation, including moderation, right? And it's interesting. It's always about balance. God, this world was created in a way where no matter where you go, you got to come back here. And it's interesting, CeeDee Lamb is doing something I actually applaud because I think there's a void on this team. However, there needs to be a balance. But there's a void on the Cowboys in terms of who going to be the fire starter, as we talk about with my Clippers, not having the proper leadership. Yes, having leadership. Yes, having leaders, but proper leadership, because you can't cook without fire. And I think CeeDee Lamb looked around and he saw the cream of the crop on the Cowboys, and let's go through it. And he like, that ain't it in terms of the Michael Irvin model. Like, Michael Irvin was the one that stirred it up when he had Troy Aikman there, Emmitt Smith there. And think about them in more ambassador roles, ballers. But are they the fire starters the same as a Michael Irvin? So CeeDee Lamb, like, wait a minute. This team is not missing just in production or accomplishment. Like you said, we ain't cooking right. This ain't the right temperature setting. Let me change it. Dak Prescott, better off running for office in Congress than he is to say, hey, guys, let's go out there and run through the wall, even though he gonna put up his numbers. Okay. I'm gonna say his name, but Ezekiel Elliott. He gonna go off the reservation. No matter where he leads you, you know sooner or later he gonna need a map. Like, where did we just go? Plus, you don't trust in him the same. To me, if you wanna go after that, Amari Cooper? Nah, bro, he just there to ball out and not say that much like that. He ain't trying to stir the pot. So CeeDee Lamb looking around, Micah Parsons, he got that in him, but he a rookie, he ain't even made a play yet, so we can't go there. CeeDee Lamb sees a void right here, and he's trying to go out there and be that fire starter. So when it comes to confidence, overconfidence, this is going to go ablaze. Let's see where it goes, because they need this if they're going to really stir the pot.
So I got to disagree with that.
Okay, let's go.
I think the Cowboys have a whole bunch of fire starters. They ain't got no gas. Think about this.
What are you talking about?
Feed me, feed me, feed me. Jalen Smith.
It's out of control.
Jalen Smith, bird's eye view, his celebration. Leighton Vander Esch, woo, howls after every tackle. DeMarcus Lawrence, hot boys. They got all the nicknames in the world.
First of all those guys have been inconstant in play.
But it doesn't mean they're not trying to fire start. All them dudes.
But that's the point. A qualification. We got to have a line of qualification, a resume. There has to be a minimum. You got to get 1,300 on the SAT to come to this school. The school of fire starting. CeeDee Lamb, first year as a rookie. Qualifies.
Okay. What about Zeke's first year as a rookie?
No, but Zeke then burns down the house that he's trying to warm up. That's the problem. Zeke, you think they're going to trust Zeke? Like, being real, if he's your teammate, you're like, I love Zeke. I hang with Zeke. I trust Zeke. Never mind, Zeke. I hear you another way. Let me give it to you like I gave it to my son. Damn, this is beautiful. This is the only time I'm ever going to have a baseball analogy, I think. All my track ones, I love them. This baseball one. Of the major sports, because my son is like, he want to taste everything, even taekwondo. My son don't know, he don't know what he wants to do, but he want to do it and do it well. So baseball, we were trying to figure out baseball in terms of conceptualizing it, philosophy. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know, of all the sports you've tried, all the major sports, MJ, baseball is the only one you can try your hardest and it's okay. And he's like, what? I said, you can swing that bat as hard as you can and hit that ball as far as you want. And he was like, yeah. I was like, think about it. In football, you can't just go up there and just throw the ball as far as you want.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, in basketball, you can't just shoot the ball as far as you want. It takes a certain level, as I said before, balance. Now, baseball doesn't ask for that same balance, but it asks for it in a different way. Here's baseball. Swing as hard as you want. Under control.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what I think about CeeDee Lamb. Be as confident as you want. In balance. Under control. Zeke is out of control, like in terms of his confidence. Dak is too under control
in terms of his confidence.
So they need somebody who's going to swing the hell out of that thing, but with the proper balance, proper control. Hopefully it's you, CeeDee Lamb, because the Cowboys need to do something this year. Coming up, LeBron's not used to hearing this, but he had a first-round exit. Yep. We'll tell you if his title window with the Lakers has closed. That's next on Speak for Yourself.
The Lakers will not be repeating this year after the Suns eliminated them last night. And LeBron's 3 years in L.A., he's missed the playoffs, won a title in the bubble, and was beaten in the first round for the first time in his career. LeBron is 36 years old and joked that this summer he's going to play for the Toon Squad in Space Jam 2. Slick Rick is back with us. What up, Slick? Mm. But Marcellus, you up first.
Yes.
Has LeBron's title window closed with the Lakers?
Yeah, it's over. As currently constructed, these Los Angeles Lakers, if they stay at this talent level, if they did what they did last year, just try to revamp number three on in the roster. Actually, number four, because they kept Kuzma. If you try to revamp that, Kuzma, boy. What a difference some years make. They're not going to do anything. They got a Brooklyn edit. It's just as simple as that. If they don't add a major third piece, Steph Curry as everyone's float, Damian Lillard as one float, if they don't go that level, it's a wrap, because now you're banking on another year older LeBron James and Anthony Davis with his injury concerns once again. Absolutely not. LeBron James, in full respect, because you know I think he's the GOAT, because he's done more with a basketball in his hand than anybody else who's ever played the game, is coming down the hill. We're going to see how good his breaks are, because he's coming down the hill right now. I can see him right now chilling in that big old mansion he got. Samantha looking over. He's like, you hear that? He was like, nah, there ain't nobody. No, somebody in here. Who that? Check out on the cameras. That's Father Time. He in the house now. he looking for you, bro. He knows it's going to take a minute because you got a big-ass house. But he coming. He's somewhere in that crib. And it's a wrap. If y'all keep this roster on this talent level again next year, y'all going to see how this West really rolls.
Sells exactly right on this one. I think it's done for the Lakers as it looks like with this roster.
Right.
But here's my thing, so I'm going to go more specific.
Okay.
The Lakers don't just need any talented addition. They need someone like a Bradley Beal when it comes to scorers.
Ooh, got him.
That's exactly what they need. Y'all, I think LeBron James is the greatest player with the basketball still playing right now. But the Lakers would have been better served with a Steph, with a KD, with the Harden last night, because what the Lakers did not need was a great basketball player yesterday. The Lakers needed a great scorer.
Mm.
They didn't need somebody who could pass the ball to an open shooter just for the open shooter to miss. They didn't need somebody who would, give me that, get a ball off the board. That's what they needed, Slick.
Mm.
They so desperately needed a great scorer, and that is not what they currently have, especially when you assume AD will not be healthy. Lakers, from here on out, you ought to assume you ain't have AD. Period. You can't factor him in to your championship aspirations. Assume he will not be there, and if you have him, that is a bonus. I'm talking about health, not because of a departure. But go through the West. The 8th seed was the Grizzlies, Ja Morant. He can get you 50 at any point in time. Skip the 7th seed, that's the Lakers. Then you got your 6th seed, whether you talk about the Mavericks or even the Blazers. Dame can give you 50 at any point in time. Luka can give you 50 at any point in time. Suns, Booker can give you 50 at any point in time. Nuggets, Jamal Murray, assuming he's healthy. Remember last year, he gave you 50, 42, and 50 in three consecutive games. The Lakers need somebody who is just an assassin when it comes to getting a bucket. I really don't care how much defense you can play. I really don't care how many boards you can get. But when I sat there and I watched Devin Booker, when I sat there and I, before that game, and I watched Michael Porter Jr. get you 6 trays, I'm like, Lord, I've seen what you've done for others. Can you please do it for the Lakers too?
Mm.
Again, Acho, God's got to step in, and again, I mean, he gave you the bubble last year. Come on. How much are you asking for? Here's the reality. Yes, the window is closed, and the question is, can Lakers GM Rob Pelinka open it again?
Mm-hmm.
Because let's not forget where we were 2 years ago with what the team that LeBron had. And yes, they were able to get AD over the summer. But then they added a lot of pieces that we didn't think a whole lot of at the time. And yet it came together and it ended up winning a championship. Asterisk, bubble, whatever. So I'm not saying that it can't happen again. But I can take you into the weeds a little bit and tell you that window's not just painted over. It's got a couple nails driven in it as well. Because their cap situation, as it stands, they are in a world of hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they don't re-sign Dennis Schroeder, Montrezl Harrell, Markieff Morris, and Andre Drummond, if Montrezl Harrell opts into his player option, they are basically capped out. So that means, can I flip a Kentavious Caldwell-Pope to improve? Can I flip a Kyle Kuzma?
No.
I'm not going to say that it's impossible.
Okay.
to open that window again. But that's what Rob Pelinka is looking at in being able to reconfigure this team. The bottom line is, to Marcellus's point, you can't just re-sign and run it back as it was this year and think that you're going to win a championship. There's going to have to be some changes made in order to reopen that window.
Yes, I'm glad you brought up the cap situation. And please, Trez, opt in so you can strap this team. That's the Clipper thing to do. Like, you owe us one, big dog. Like, you left us in the same building. Opt in, and the boys are stuck. Because if you look at their cap situation, not much to work with. And they only got five players with guaranteed contracts. LeBron, AD, KCP, Kuzma, and Gasol. I'm going to say that again, y'all. Y'all think that's going to win in this West now? Y'all know what the West looking like? You think Phoenix is going anywhere right now? The Warriors get Steph, Clay, and a lottery pick next year to add to a team that still has Wiggins and the boys. Good Lord. Lakers had the oldest roster coming into this season. And these young guns ain't playing. You may not respect them. You may not see it coming. It may blindside you. But guess what? It's there, and it's better than yours. So, old Betsy, I want to call these Lakers right now. You know, old Betsy in the garage. You think old Betsy, oh, got this big old engine. Oh, and Betsy could beat anything on the road. See old Betsy at a red light. Old Betsy gonna smoke you. Okay, so they think that all they got to do is wash and tune up old Betsy, and old Betsy gonna do something on the road. Well, y'all know me. I'm Mr. Tesla up here. Call me Elon Musk. Yep. Got me a Tesla. Look like a minivan, a mail truck, whatever you want to call it, right? Got three car seats in the back. Yes, I do. And I've been at the red light before. And these young cats, you know, they act like I ain't got no money, or I got some money, but I'm an old man with money. And I had a Ferrari before. And I remember this one time, this dude at the red light had a Ferrari. He looking at me, 454, white one. Ooh, I wanted it. But anyway, he's sitting at the red light. He look, vroom, vroom. I'm like, oh, you want some smoke? Boy, you see these car seats in here. I ain't racing you, you fool. But you can go to Motor Trend Car Report and realize, my Tesla faster than that. And you can't even tell. You can't even see it. And that's what's happening to these Lakers. Throw old Betsy out there with a tune-up in a car wash and think it's going to run faster than these young things blindsiding you. It ain't going to happen. It's going to sneak you, LeBron. You better add up.
Yeah, word to all you youngins out there. Don't mess with those EVs. They get off the line really fast. I don't care whether it's a Tesla or it's a Kia. It's going to mess with you.
Yes.
That said, I want to double down on something that Acho mentioned, because I do think there is one thing that has been permanently closed, and it doesn't matter what Rob Pelinka does, it will not change this fact. And it is that LeBron James is no longer capable of just taking any particular crew and making it a championship team. He needs specific help. He needs specific pieces, and they have to be talented in a way and proven in a way that we've never seen before. That's what has permanently changed. That's what was still alive when he won a championship in the bubble. We're like, with Dwight Howard? With JaVale McGee? Like, with Jared Dudley? Like, he took all these, but with an old Rajon Rondo? He took Kyle Kuzma? Like, took all these pieces and still won a championship? The proof in this year is clearly that he needs help, and he needs a lot of it. Not just a healthy AD, but to Acho's point, he needs that go-to guy. He needs his next Kyrie Irving if he's hoping to ever sniff a title again.
But Slick, I don't know if that's as much an indictment on LeBron James or a testament to everyone else. Because remember, the team that LeBron James, the least talented team that LeBron James carried the furthest, was his 07 Cavaliers team. The one he took to a championship, they lose to the Spurs, they lose in 07, 06, 07. Lose to the Spurs, they get swept. But the kicker now is, when you look at the West, one which is harder than the East was back in 07 when LeBron carried that squad, in the West, even an 8 seed got a Ja Morant. Even a 6 seed got a Luka, a KP, and a Tim Hardaway, who's now giving you 20-plus a game in the playoffs. Even a 4 seed got a MVP in the Joker. Like, even a 3 seed has a team with Kawhi and PG. A 2 seed got a future Hall of Famer and a Devin Booker who scored 70 in a game before. So I don't know, Slick, that it's LeBron is no longer capable, because LeBron's talent has drastically declined or drastically diminished, as much as you got teams in the East that have 3 future Hall of Famers that are arguably or inarguably all in their prime, Kevin Durant, Kyrie, James Harden. Then you got a West that is stacked
Is it an indictment on LeBron? I'm not convinced.
Okay, but did he win in the bubble last year with that go-to score? Did he need that guy, that Bradley Beal, that Ja Morant, that who was that on last year's team? He demonstrated last year that he was capable of doing that without that star scorer. So I'm just saying, if we're now saying that has to be part of the formula, that's a change.
The change for me is this. If LeBron would have had AD this year, we know they would have beat the Suns because we saw what they did with the Suns when they had AD giving them 34 and 11. If LeBron has AD this year, I think at a minimum they get back to the finals. I think they need another scorer because I'm not banking on AD. From here on out, as a Lakers fan, I'm assuming the roster doesn't have AD on it, even if he's currently on the roster because he could be hurt. But if you had AD, Slick, I don't think the Lakers need that extra piece. I'm just making a safe assumption. I ain't counting him in because he always out.
Here's the thing, man. I love the fact that we're talking about what kind of calculus that LeBron must play in order to design his team. And I want to remind people of how LeBron before as the GM didn't properly design his team once, maybe even twice. Let's talk about 2013, 2014. Remember last year in Miami when the Spurs upset them? So then he goes back to Cleveland. And remember the letter with no Wiggins name in it and all the speculation? Turns out no Wiggins on the team. LeBron miscalculated that team and didn't design it properly. He was thinking about going back to Cleveland to face the Spurs. Who blindsided him at the line? What Tesla showed up at the line? The Golden State Warriors out of nowhere, and LeBron was doomed. Let's rewind, go back to when he went to Miami in that Big Three. As much as we love the Big Three, in 4 years they win two championships, they go to the championship every single year. They only won half the time. So it's interesting, what calculus does LeBron play? I'm with Slick more so. It's not just the score. It's the proper type. And he needs some rim protection because LeBron, especially on defense, is starting to pick his spots, being a little too specific, a little too selective. Got to cover those warts. Coming up, Kawhi's Clippers have a must-win game tonight. I'll tell you how important this is for his legacy. That's next on Speak for Yourself. My Clippers have a must-win game tonight against the Mavericks on the road. Kawhi Leonard, the Claw, is averaging about 30 points in this series, but it's not been enough. His squad was bounced in the second round in his first season in L.A., and now in year two, he's on the brink of a first-round exit. Damn, Slick Rick is back with us, but Acho, how important, and be nice, be careful, is tonight for Kawhi Leonard's legacy?
It's not. How important is Floyd Mayweather's bout with Logan Paul for his legacy? Kawhi Leonard has nothing to gain and only things to lose, just like Floyd Mayweather, y'all. If Kawhi Leonard loses tonight, well, then all of a sudden we realize he can't be ushered into that upper echelon of superstar athlete that we tried to put him in. What do I mean? Kevin Durant, he leaves the Thunder. He goes to Golden State. He wins instantly, two-time finals MVP. LeBron James, he leaves Cleveland, he goes to the Heat, he instantly goes to the finals, and the next year he wins the finals, and the next year he wins the finals, and the next year he's in the finals. Superstar athletes, they leave, and they instantly acquire what we all thought they would acquire. Kawhi Leonard, he to a degree did that after the Spurs. He leaves, joins Toronto. A few years later, he wins again. So we thought, well, Kawhi, you're in your athletic prime at the time. You're 28 years old, superstar athlete. You're being compared to Michael Jordan. You're going to leave, join forces with another star athlete in PG and instantly win. But last year, he won a series and got bounced. Tonight, he's on the verge of getting bounced. So I don't think there's anything Kawhi can do tonight to help his legacy, only hurt his legacy. If you lose tonight, you look at yourself. You went to the Clippers, and all you have to show for it is one playoff series win. If you win tonight, congratulations, you still got to win game 7, and winning ultimately means nothing unless you win a chip, because that's what they brought you to L.A. for.
Mm. Okay, Acho, you converted the question, because it was how important is it to his legacy, not whether it could do anything for his legacy. And it is critical, essential, crucial, whatever word you want to put on it, because Kawhi not only has the potential of losing a shot at this year's championship, to your point, Acho, he has the possibility of having his last two championships revisited and discounted. We've been talking about discounted championships. Mm. This would be another example of that. Because let's look at this. Yes, he won a championship in San Antonio and then Toronto, and we thought the common denominator is Kawhi Leonard. So obviously, he's a champion. He goes to the Clippers, and he's given not one, but two head coaches who have won titles previously. He is given his chosen co-star and running mate in Paul George. He's given the fourth highest payroll in the entire league, and now he faces the potential of losing to the 18th highest potential payroll. Oh, and by the way, also losing to a young star who nearly knocked him out last year. So it's not only that he would have his championships discounted, but his place in the hierarchy of great players in the league right now, if he loses tonight, Luka Doncic becomes his daddy until further notice. That's what he has at stake tonight.
I'm telling Kwame Brown on you. You just said he's going to be his daddy. Oh, man. First of all, we beat them 4-2 last year, homeboy. That ain't a gentleman's sweep. It's like a homeboy sweep. But guess what it is? It ain't that close, 4-2. You can cook in these numbers in these books over here. All right. You got me a little fired up on that one. Kawhi Leonard's legacy. How important is tonight? I'm with Acho. It don't mean nothing to Kawhi. You know why it doesn't mean anything to his legacy? Because it doesn't mean anything to the person. Why did Russell Westbrook get popcorn thrown on him? You brought this up to me, Acho. It was interesting because they knew they could get a reaction potentially, right? When it comes to a legacy, I swear the helium, what makes a legacy even created and gain some traction in terms of importance is this statement. If you live by others' praise, you'll die by others' criticism. Let's talk about legacy because Tim Duncan didn't say much, right? And Kawhi is even quieter than Tim Duncan. He's an enigma, as they would say. But at least Tim Duncan was tethered to Kobe. Remember that? And then every time Kobe do something, then we had to look at Tim Duncan over there. And Kobe had higher highs, but Tim Duncan had more consistent excellence and five chips. So we were taking Tim Duncan's legacy to places where he deserved it, he earned it, but also where we wanted it. What y'all gonna do with Kawhi? He already got multiple championships. Two different spots. He went to a place that never won a championship, played 1 year, and they won a championship. That's a made man. That's what his legacy looks like. He's playing with so much house money that he acts like he's playing with house money. Seriously, you're talking about a finals MVP who's already got multiple championships, and now you say he comes to the lowliest franchise and he can't make them win one. And who has? Who has done what Kawhi has been tasked to do? So all that tells me that it's not going to land anywhere. We're going to throw a lot at the wall. Trust me. And Kawhi going to be walking around just whistling, giggling at it because it's not going to matter.
But here's the kicker, Sal. Kawhi's not that rich. He's just comfortable in his tax bracket. And I'm talking basketball.
Okay, I'm about to say.
The kicker isn't that Kawhi Leonard is actually wealthy, the most wealthy in terms of basketball. He's not as wealthy as Kevin Durant. And I'm not talking money here. I'm talking about basketball wealth. Not as wealthy as LeBron James. If we're being real, probably not as wealthy as Steph Curry. But I think he's just comfortable in his lane. So
Nice neighborhood.
For really sure. Nice. It just depends on what you want to do. Do you want to fall down as an all-time top 10 great? Which, remember, we were going to expedite fast past Kawhi Leonard. If he would have went to L.A., won a finals MVP, and won a chip, we were about to look around and say, yo, three finals MVPs, three different teams, first time in one team, first time in one team, and early on in your career in the other team, we were going fast past him in the top 10 of all time. But I think Kawhi Leonard is just fine waiting in line and maybe not even riding the ride. I think he's just cool, like being at the theme park. He's just happy he's there. He'll ride a couple rides here. He'll ride a couple rides there. Oh, you know, some cats, LeBron James, KD. No, I want to be in the front of the line. I want to get on first. Kawhi is just fun to watch other people like LeBron yell and scream when they win multiple titles. Watch KD yell and scream when at least he goes to multiple titles. Oh, and Kawhi is like, I got my two, got my finals MVPs. I'm fine. Let me just get the popcorn in. And hey, can you print me off the picture, please, before I
leave? that's a robbery. Never get that picture. You going down the hill screaming like that. You'll never look at it again once you leave the park.
What is it with you guys today? Is it Friday?
Yes.
That we keep changing the question? First, Acho does
it. I do it every day, actually.
And then Marcellus does it. It's not how important is tonight's game to Kawhi's legacy in Kawhi's mind. Oh, it's to his legacy in general, not how legacy. He perceives it, Marcellus.
I kind of weave between
them.
You can't
go there.
All right, I weave between them, but you're look, right. I tried to lean this way because I knew it would help my argument, but give it to me. Tell me. I don't see it.
So here's the distinction. And I wish that I had built a full screen for this, but I just found it. So, but this is what happens, is that when you get put in a position like this with Kawhi, we start to revisit everything that you've accomplished previously and look at it more closely and say, well, did he really do that? Or did he really play the part that we think he did in those games? Since he became a Clipper, both last year and this year, through two rounds last year, through this round so far this year, Kawhi Leonard's plus minus is directly connected to every win and every loss that the Clippers have had in the playoffs. Now, if you go back to Toronto and you go back to San Antonio, it's a different story. And I'm going to have to check my notes here on this. But if you go back to Toronto, Game 7, the win over Philadelphia in Game 7, the clincher, he was minus two. Game 6, the win over Golden State to win the championship, he was minus two. If you go back to San Antonio, the Western Conference Finals, the win over OKC in Game 6, he was minus six. You suddenly look at those pivotal games, those winning games that won him championships previously, and you look at it and you go, huh, wait a minute. Kawhi was a negative when the team accomplished something positive. Mm-hmm. And here we are with the Clippers, and everything that he does positive ends up with a win, and everything that he does negative ends up with a loss. So I don't know that we can hang all of the previous accomplishments on Kawhi, but we certainly can hang all of the accomplishments and the failures as a Clipper directly on Kawhi Leonard.
Wow. Wow.
He's onto something, Sam. Yeah,
wow, his grace.
I'll be here next week, too.
Are you not entertained? What are you talking about here? Oh, his grade suffered because he went to the worst, most violent school in the nation's history.
Oh, stop downgrading your Clippers just because it fits your narrative.
Stop it.
We had Lob City. Don't even.
All right, here we go.
Donald Sterling left the building a long time ago. Get out of here with that, Marcellus. I ain't giving you that.
You ain't going to give it to me, and I ain't going to take it. And Kawhi don't care what you do with it. And that's the beautiful thing about this question right here. I got two levels to it. One, Slick, we can't take down a statue. So all this revisiting history, hey, man, we went through enough of that already. People going back to the 1700s taking down stuff. You can't take down something that just happened 2 years ago. Leave Kawhi's legendary status alone. Let's talk about this legendary status, because, Acho, you built it off a premise that I questioned. You said Kawhi ain't happy being a top 10 player. You better be happy with what you are, because is he a top 10 player? How could he have gotten into this top 10? You ready? When Kobe is on the border of being a top 10 player, LeBron, Jordan, Magic, Kareem, Wilt, that's five, Russell, Shaq, Hakeem, Bird, Duncan, 10, Kobe, 11. You think he gonna trump one of those guys because he come to the Clippers and win a championship with Paul George with that high payroll? I mean, it could be a conversation for another day, but let's be real, dog. Just be happy with what you got. And what does he have? Five-time All-Star, six-time All-Defense, two NBA championships, two Finals MVP, Defensive Player of the Year, plays for the richest owner, plays for the best team, plays for the Clippers, Clippers, and the Chip City, we're going to win the next two games. And Kawhi Leonard going to be laughing at y'all with his legacy. Coming up, Patrick Mahomes clarified his 20-0 comments. Don't get me upset about Kawhi. Patrick Mahomes clarified his 20-0 comments, but we'll tell you if that was even necessary. That's next. Speak for yourself. You think he'd be top 10 for real?
You're like one of those commercial guys with all...
Let's head to KC. Because Patrick Mahomes made headlines recently when he said the only record he wants to break was his Chiefs going 20-0 this season. Mahomes went into further detail yesterday saying, quote, people get all hyped saying 20-0, but I'm not going into the season thinking I'm going to lose any game. So, Sal, did Patrick Mahomes need to clarify his 20-0 comments?
Sounds like Patrick Mahomes felt like he needed to clarify it, and that's all that matters. Man, he told on himself. And I knew it. When he said that, I was like, man, what you talking about? There are too many variables you can't control in terms of going 20-0 for you to even proclaim that you want or can go 20-0. You add them up. Nick Saban style. You add them up. Bill Belichick style. You add them up. Tom Brady style. I know it's boring. I know it's AM radio. It's not the FM. It's not digital. It's not streaming. But guess what? That's how you do it. 1-0. Okay, we're trying to go 2-0. But nah, he wanted to go out there and say, let's just go 20-0. Now, hit dogs, holla. throw that rock into that pack of dogs. Oh, you got one of them. And he got hit. So in clarification, all of a sudden he wants to flip it. He wants to flip it into something less to be more in others' eyes. Because all he's doing is responding to those random comments of people like myself who are like, what are you talking about? And it shouldn't matter what we're talking about. It should matter about what you're going to do. But he stopped down to clarify. It's okay to clarify, dog, when you fumble something like I do on this show all the time. I fumble something in rhetoric. I fumble something in my intention. But the logic of what he was saying, all he tried to do was soften it. But he still means the same thing. Dog, I will bet you right now, 100,000 push-ups, they ain't going 20 or no. And he knows it too. So now he's trying to clarify it because really it's not clear to him because he know he ain't going 20 or no.
I don't think he needed to clarify it. And I don't necessarily think he did clarify it. He just dumbed it down.
Ooh.
Like, Patrick Mahomes said he wanted to go 20-0. His clarification simply said, I don't care about going 20-0 if I don't win a championship. But anybody with common sense understands, if you go 20-0, there's an implication you're going to win a championship. Because you went 20-0. So that's why I don't get the clarification. The only problem with saying you want to go 20-0 or I want to go undefeated is because you don't have the mental approach like Marcellus, you're saying, take it one game at a time. You're focused on the destination as opposed to being focused on the process. But when you say you want to go undefeated, when you say you want to go 20-0, you are also encapsulating, I want to win a championship.
Yes.
And none of us would have been mad if he said, I want to win a championship and I don't want to lose any games. So I don't get how people got mad at him saying, I want to go 20-0. He didn't even really clarify it. He just dumbed it down for the people that couldn't digest it.
Yeah, but you know what? Nah, I ain't gonna let him. I mean, you gave him an out because he was like, you just dumbed it down. But I thought it was dumb to say in the first place. You know what? And this is not.
But why?
Why? Because you got to respect not only your opponent, you got to respect the process. When they came off of their Super Bowl championship, they walked around with some kind of level of arrogance.
Correct.
That said, why stop at one? Why stop at two, six, seven? I remember the comments.
Mm-hmm.
How about stop at one? Because y'all stopped at one. And that's what it is. It's not about fear. It's about respect. And right now, he just seemed like he was going to be a symbol of not respecting that process. So I ain't tripping. Here's the thing that happened to my wife about a month ago. And this is why I don't stop down and try to clarify. When you get backlash, all it is he got backlash. He got people pushing back. He's like, no, let me clarify. Mm-hmm. When you stop down, you don't get to your destination fast enough. What are you trying to really prove to us? Because you can't prove to us you're going to go 20-0 or 0-20 right now. And it's June. We don't give a damn. Mm-hmm. Just go out there and play. But you're trying to express, say something that you want us to all just absorb and accept. It ain't going to work that way. That's not the process. So why stop down? My wife stopped down. She made a comment out the box for her on her little private account with her friends. Her friends are like, what you talking about? Oh, let me clarify. I was like, babe, why you get off your square? Why you got to clarify to them? It's not about the clarification. It's about your intention. If you intend to go 20-0, go 20-0. But I don't want to hear you going to get there before you even left here. And right now, they look like they stuffed right where they are. Coming up, LeBron did not shake the Suns' hands after his first round exit. We'll tell you if it was a bad look. That's next on Speak for Yourself. Ain't nobody. Good luck. LeBron James was eliminated in the first round for the first time in his career last night. And he did not wait around when the clock hit zero. Come on, LeBron. LeBron made his way to the locker room after the game without shaking the Suns' hands. I guess he needed some more treatment for the offseason. So, Otto, was it a bad look that LeBron did not shake hands with the Suns because the sun is hot?
No, it wasn't at all. I mean, I think it was a bad look that Jay Crowder got ejected and sprinted off the court before the game. I think it might have been a bad look that I'm just saying.
LeBron apologizes?
If we want to talk about bad, no.
Oh, we can't do this.
Let's be real. I'm going to be real for all y'all.
Okay, I was going to say.
You know what they say, Sal, and you know better than I in relationships. Don't go to bed angry. Right, with your significant
other. They always
say
that, and that's a lie.
It's a lie. Why?
Because when you go to sleep and 8 hours go by, you wake up happier.
Bingo.
Yeah.
They say don't go to bed angry because you should resolve the issue before you go to sleep.
Yeah.
But like Marcellus, a married man, just told and educated me along with you all is, sometimes give it some time,
mm-hmm.
let the time pass,
step out.
Reconvene a little bit later, and it's all Gucci.
Yeah.
That's what LeBron did.
Mm.
He went to the locker room. He gave it some time. Jay Crowder had just gotten ejected. Devin Booker had just got teed up. So they clearly hostile. LeBron James just got eliminated in the first round for the first time in his career. So he's clearly hostile. So what did he do? He gave it some time. They went to bed angry. But what happened at the end of the game if y'all didn't see the images?
Not only did LeBron go back and greet Devin Booker, if we got the pictures y'all throw it up, but he signed his jersey for Devin Booker. He didn't just give him a handshake. He gave him something worth roughly $1 million. What? A signed game-worn jersey from LeBron's only playoff elimination in the first round.
Oh,
that's a little bit more than a handshake, if I'm not mistaken.
Them NTGs or something, what they got going on? The hell are worth $1 million where?
You don't think a LeBron signed?
No, I know it's worth more than more or not. What I got. But
so with that being said, I have no issue with it. He took some time because the Suns were hostile, Lakers and LeBron was hostile, and they all made amends at the end of the game.
But why are you hostile? What's the old quote, Lombardi and all that? If you leave it out there on the field, you know, a man should feel great that he left it all out there. You know, like, he didn't leave it all on the court. Only time I've ever been upset after losses, for real, not just acting it. Look, mm-hmm. Of course I've all disappointed. I'm not talking about that. You kept saying he was hot. Upset is when I cheated myself anywhere in that process to that defeat. That's when I felt bad. But if I left it all out there, I did all I could, what else can I do? It's that. But you know what? I would believe your take if I didn't have the game before when they were down 30 and he didn't want to sit there and deal with that moment. LeBron's into some, like, extensive brand imaging that he doesn't want to be around when it's all bad. When they down 30, you trying to get 20 more minutes of treatment so you can't be there. When you lose a game like this, you don't want the cameras to catch you in another bad moment. Stick it out with your boys. But they help get you
here. No, we're not going to have double standards.
Yes,
here's my thing is,
yes,
Sal.
Yes, we are.
The dudes who dap up at the end of the game, it's the starters, you dap up against the starters. Like, hey, big dog, it was good competition. It was good competition.
My dog.
The backups, you dap up the backups. Like, hey, big dog,
all right.
What you doing next? Okay,
you
going out?
You're
going
to make it.
That's what happens. The starters for the Phoenix Suns, one, Jay Crowder. Y'all run a clip because I just saw it. He's sprinting off the court.
That's one.
Jovially sprinting.
That's
that
one.
Was the main person who guarded LeBron
That's
James all
one.
Game. So who was LeBron going to dap up?
His
the
best.
Dude who just got ejected, who clowned
best.
LeBron James as soon as the game ended on Twitter.
Is that all
who
you
just
got?
Posted it. Ain't no fun with a rabbit.
There's four other starters.
Go.
Is that all you got?
Devin Booker.
Yep.
That's who you finna shake hands with?
Keep going.
Yeah, talking all that cash, money right there and then.
Oh, that's LeBron too much for LeBron to say.
No, but I'm just saying.
That's two.
What am I going to – those are the two dudes he would have shook hands with.
Really?
We don't care that LeBron didn't shake hands with Campaign. We don't care that LeBron James didn't shake hands with Eaton. We don't care. We care that LeBron James didn't shake hands with Book. We care that LeBron James didn't shake hands with Crowder. Crowder wasn't there. And
it.
Book, he sat there at the end
Damn,
of the game. You talking about Chris Paul?
His best friend is on the other team. He can even sit there and say, look, if I ain't seen at you since I seen at you, it don't matter where I see you. What's up, Acho? You trying to tell me, oh, we're going to do a competition. You wanted a debate. Oh, I can't be here to be seen and say what's up and dap you up for your win. Dog, I don't know. I got two in a row right now on LeBron. He don't want to be there when the pot is hot. It's a little issue right there. But speaking of the pot getting a little hot, we had a little bet, Acho, since you want to sit there and not be there when it's hot. You're going to get on that floor right now because we had
You could have been nicer. You could have been nicer. You could have said, like, hey, can you get me the push-ups that you owe me?
No.
You could have been a little
You got
bit.
Me hot. I'm Jay Crowder right now. Dub. I want
this
triangle.
This is the only time
and
I'm going to lose a bet. And I'm going to give you the full ups and downs.
D-block.
That's one.
Okay,
that's two. That's three. That's four. That's five.
Oh, you counting for me.
Six,
okay, you're good.
That's seven.
Look
that's eight.
All right.
That's nine. That's 10.
Buckle up.
That's 11. That's 12. That's 13. I'm tired.
Boy, you over here clinching. You okay?
That's 16. That's 17. Mm. That's 18. That's 19. That's 20. And here's 20. Here's for the Clippers lost. That's one for the Clippers lost because they taking the L tonight and you're going to be back down there on me what's really mine.
Oh, man. I appreciate it. I needed that little water break. And y'all think on the Friday show this is water, y'all tripping.